So the final session that we are going to have is going to be slightly interactive, where we are not doing a panel session at all. We want to actually start with a video where we have interviewed Bibin across three generations. Bibin is computing across three generations, and we have built a video around that. It's a small, short movie, and then we want to have an interactive session after that, so nothing to do with panels. I would like to introduce... I can't see it. I'm sorry. I would like to introduce Apala Chavan from Human Factors, but let me just check if the video is working. Just a moment. Apala is from Human Factors. She's going to explain a little bit more about Human Factors and what she and her team does. So we'll just wait for this to start. Thank you.
And so therein lies a tale, which is that neither of us have ever attended a conference on computing. And that's because, you know, user experience design is a very schizophrenic field. It doesn't know whether it belongs in the area of computing or not. Depends on which school you studied, which organization you work in. And so we always attend, you know, user experience design conferences. And we were wondering when we were coming here that will we understand anything? Will it be too technical? Will we look really stupid? And to be honest, I have to say that it's been very, very interesting. We've just attended three panel discussions. You know, we've been sitting here and it's been so engaging that in our user experience design conferences, it's all about the papers and all that, which is, of course, interesting. But here, it was about real life in a way. It was about very practical stuff and very relevant to us. So we were very surprised and we were messaging our colleagues saying, hey, next year, you know, spend the money to come here. Let's not just go to conferences where you can anyway read the papers, it's, you know, that you know about. So I think it would be wonderful if this conference continues and we look forward to being back next year. So now to the story of the film that we would like to show you. This film, the idea of the film came from a personal interest to know more about the story of women in computing, because for a very brief period, I did work as a programmer, but that was a long time ago. And it's always intrigued me. You know, I've looked for information since then, since I moved on 20 years ago from that, you know, that area. I've looked for information about women in computing in India. And what I've found is a lot of information about the products they've made, the papers they've written, the patents that have been filed, but I've not found information about who they are. Who are these women? What, you know, when they get up in the morning, what do they think? Do they really look forward to going to work when they step in? What happens? What discussions do they have in the office? And I've always been very curious about this, and that led to the idea that let's bring, you know, manifest and articulate this story in whatever way we can. And so what we've tried to do is to bring you snippets of individual journeys of women in computing, 15 women with whom we've spoken, spanning across three generations. And so a generation that, you know, came in 20, 25 years ago in this field, we've asked them, as you look back, do you regret anything? Or do you really feel thrilled about what you've achieved? Do your children look up to you and say, oh, mom's the hero? You know, what happens? Then the generation that is in middle management today, we've talked to them, and similarly, we wanted to know, what do they think looking forward? They have, you know, much more to achieve. What is their frame of mind today? And finally, the students in computer science, they're studying computer science today. What are they thinking? What aspiration? Are they, you know, do they look at this as just another routine field that they'll get into? Or are they still very excited? So these conversations we'll present to you. But the hope is that we, in future, we want to continue to document the story and celebrate the journey of women in computing in different ways. Since we are designers, so we would like to use different media. This time it's a film. Maybe next time we'll use paintings and sculpture. We'll use storytelling. But we would like to continue that. It's a very inspiring story, and I think it needs to reach a lot more people about the real you, all of you as real people. That story needs to go out and inspire more women and more men. So today, I hope you will, at the end of the film, you know, introspect and celebrate your own journeys, and you will share the insights you've had, which you may think are unimportant, but actually they could inspire a lot of people. And so with that, I'll hand over to my colleague Ananya. She actually shot the film and put it together. So to share her experience while she made the movie, and then we'll start the movie.
Thanks, Apala. So when Apala shared the idea for this film with me, I was really excited to, you know, go out and interview women and put it together. Firstly, because I'm always excited about anything that involves women exclusively. And also not coming from a background in computing, I was extremely curious to see, you know, what we would find finally. So firstly, I'd like to thank the women who made this possible. It was an absolute privilege that they gave us to, you know, allow me into their homes, offices, wherever I went and met them. And then, you know, letting me into their minds and lives for a little while. And I hope the stories they've, you know, shared, you'll see in the film. I hope they'll entertain you, enlighten you, and inspire you. So enjoy the film.
We'll take questions later, but till then we'll join you in the audience.
So I got computer science because computer science is the branch in IIT Bombay which only top 100 students got it. So I got 61 rank and then I got the computer science. So I'm the lucky one, I think.
I joined the field of computing right after I graduated from high school.
I did very well in mathematics in the school and college days. So my friends, teachers and my brothers actually encouraged me to get into this field of computing.
And also my parents, they were the back supporter, like, no, you can do, even though you are an average student, but you can do, you have the talent. So that's how I got the confidence.
I don't think that was primarily interest driven. It was more like the options available to me at that point.
You know, there was so much craze for computing in those years. It was the newest branch. So I just went by the way of
that day. I thought it will be a new emerging field, so I can do something in that.
I don't know, I mean, it has been fascinating to me ever. So I kind of took that as a goal that I have to land myself somewhere which is related to the computers.
We learned some basics of HTML and I had designed a website for my school. So when I could do such with just little knowledge, I could do something constructive. I thought if I get into the field of IT, there was much more that I could achieve and make a difference to the world.
You know, I learned Fortran or some basic or something like that, and I really liked those courses. So I decided, okay, why don't we, you know, try switching the major. So that's when I switched my major from accounting to computer science.
I met a friend who was really into wanting to do engineering. And so she was trying different avenues, and she figured out that there is a postgraduate engineering in the Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore. So she was applying for it. So she told me, why don't you also try?
I was not sure what I'm going to do, so I also applied for a PhD here. And the prof that I wanted to work with was in the computer science department, although he was a communications person. So that's how I got into this.
The campus interviews happened. The first interview I attended, I got selected. And at that point of time, I felt very jubilant. Okay, I got a job. I'm going to do something or do some kind of great achievement. So that was the only thought I had.
Actually, when I started my career in mid-80s, I had actually for a very brief period worked in electronics industry. And during the course of that tenure, actually I was introduced to the field of software.
My daughter, she was in a 7th standard at that particular point of time, and she had computer science as one of her subjects, and then she was asking my help in terms of learning it at home. I was telling her something and she said, "Amma, you don't know, this is not the way it is written." I said, "What is this? There is no grammar." "No, Amma, it does not come with grammar. This is how you write the commands." Then I said, "Okay, this is time for me to go out and learn because I have to teach her." He looked up and said, "Where is the candidate?" I said, "I'm the candidate." He really looked me and said, "Amma, please don't mistake me. How old are you?" I said, "I'm 34. I'm sorry, you're 10 years late to get into this organization."
I was obviously feeling very happy.
I was really surprised to see the infrastructure, the facilities, the workstations, the carpet, and the coffee machine. I was really excited.
It was kind of a dream come true at that point.
The first thing that came to my mind was independence.
And I was financially independent, coming from a small city and from a very middle class background.
The first time you see money in dollars, you know, when you're so always dependent on your parents' income or, you know, your husband's income or something.
I'm entering a new field where there is a lot to pick up.
So it's a combination of real happy. I could be independent, I could be earning, I could be supporting. At the same time, nervousness of saying, would you be able to deliver?
It was in 2009, so that was the peak of recession, so I was very tense with it. So when I got my first job from Samsung India Electronics Limited, one of the greatest companies to work for, I was really elated, and I just cannot describe it in words. It was really, really great day.
I was given a Mac with internet connection. So I was super excited and surprised. So that was a memorable day for me.
So I had this, you know, crisp silk tie and a white shirt and a suit and skirt and everything. So and matching shoes, and you know, so I was all excited to do. I was not even concerned about if I could do the job.
So meeting up with the people and looking at my workstation, where I said
I was more observant and thrilled and a little bit of, you know, like, will I be able to do it?
I was traveling with some seniors. So during the travel itself, I came to know a lot. And they were from marketing, whether I was joining as a software engineer. So that, on the first day itself, when I interacted with them, I got a good exposure to something other than technology and software.
I am the oldest in the organization, but I am the junior most in the organization. So, people who are years junior to me, I was reporting to them. So, they had a problem and not me.
That was probably the first time that I had landed up in a place with, you know, so many different type of people around.
And I can still remember one of the people just giving me a document and say, "Can you read and explain?" So, it was like, it was really exciting and an opportunity. I can use what I've studied.
It was a big transition from college to corporate. So I was very curious, and in fact I was peeping into people's cubicles, seeing what they were doing.
I remember less of a job, but more of being alone in a big township and settling down there and being alone first time.
That was the first time I felt that I was part of a bigger ecosystem through which I would actually be able to make a huge difference in a huge number of people's life, and I'd be able to reach out to a larger audience.
I had not probably expected that people would be so good to me, but the way they were, in spite of I being a newbie there and they being there since so many years.
Everybody was nicer than what I thought they would be. That was one thing, you know. They kind of embraced you, my seniors or my bosses.
when we were interacting with instructors, they were actually just, you know, maybe couple of years senior to us, and they had already worked at the Fortune 500 sites overseas and come back. So that was very pleasant thing. We knew that, you know, 1 or 2 years down the line, we will also be doing the same thing.
I would say I was blessed and lucky 20 years back when I got into that kind of training.
There were a lot of restrictions in, getting out. That time we used to have floppies. So that was a surprise. And it was some new things we came to know about the regulations and all that.
I was only a lady or girl at that point. So that was the first thing that was very different, or which I did not expect or have not seen it at school or college or anywhere.
So women were not to be seen in middle of manufacturing plant, right? And here you see few women and who are very highly educated. You know, so you could expect some surprises as well, like, you know, people following you or people commenting on you. So
you learn where to go attach yourself to in such a group and where to detach.
I was a bit sad, like, what I'm doing is, you know, not writing the fresh code but doing the maintenance work. I was a bit unhappy.
In school and college and all that, we didn't have things like we don't share, or, you know, we have hierarchy or bureaucracy, or there's a senior guy and then there's a junior guy and stuff like that.
I don't think I'm a cheating.
I believe I have built a very good career. I have a good job and I've been consistently performing well. And given my situation, circumstances, education, background and everything, where I stand today, I think is an achievement for me.
I feel I've become more confident and independent. That makes me feel proud.
I got to present a paper at an international conference at Netherlands.
I put up some ideas to implement in a product, and it was selected, accepted by the QCERA patent committee. So that was my first achievement.
I wanted to take up this field and I have been able to do it successfully. That's the first thing that I feel proud about.
One of the things I feel proud is being one of the key members which set up the IBM India software lab, so was responsible. So that felt like really great, having a product development lab in India.
I got the global exposure at a very early stage, and that has helped me all through. At the same time, doing IT in various other industry segments, you know, when you are at a client site, the client may be an FMCG company or manufacturing, it gives you a lot of insight into the other industry segments also when you are designing and building systems for them.
All of that varied experience have really got me into a very, very matured state that proves and helps me in performing much better as I move up the career.
Looking at my performance, the knowledge depth, the top management decided to promote me, and I played the role of project lead.
Like, I was the first person to bill for this particular client, an insurance client, to about 200 people within a period of about 2-3 years. And I felt that this was under my leadership largely, and I felt pretty good about that.
I get to develop products right from scratch, the design, the architecture, until deployment and support. So I go through the complete product cycle.
When I became the first women executive, I think that was really something for me to be proud about as a recognition. But more so, I think I got the opportunity to have a worldwide product development responsibility being driven out of India. So this was like the first that we had within the lab. So I think it was something that I feel really great having that.
I was actually heading a business unit, when I was in my 30s, and I was actually vice president in a group even when I was in 30s. So I think that was a good achievement.
I'm proud that I'm a teacher,
because rather than working with some dumb systems, I'm dealing with students. So it's like dealing with human beings. So I'm getting the output at the same instance when I'm giving the input.
Then a lot of people ask for advices about their children's career and education. That kind of makes me feel proud.
Because I've seen people just go into management or choose a different career path, branch out completely from computer science, but I'm still holding on to it and I'm really happy with it. So that's something I've achieved.
I'm not a born entrepreneur. I'm a first generation entrepreneur. I'm not an IIT or an IM or a Harvard educated grad. I am not into a family business environment. I'm not into a moneyed family. With all these things being as normal as the person next door, if I could achieve something of this nature in this business, is that, look, you can also do it. It's not difficult. It's that what you want to do, if you really know and then you put your love into it, you can achieve it.
I want to be a CEO of some best company like Google and Microsoft, like that. And
when I started my own company.
Starting a venture of my own, that I would consider that as a top achievement.
I have children who will learn from me and who will look up to their mom when it comes to their own work life a few years down the line. So I certainly feel that I should be a role model at workplace as well as at home.
I want to make my parents infinitely happy.
My parents are proud about me. Wherever I am, whatever I have achieved, my parents are very proud of me. So that makes me proud.
Okay, on family side also, I am quite happy, doing very well, family and personal front. So that is also a big achievement.
The balance, between professional and personal life.
I want to go on a world trip.
I have traveled a lot in this whole career, and that has given me a chance to learn a lot about the outside world.
I mean, I've met a huge number of people and met some brilliant people through what I do.
I made good money for my family and my kids. So obviously, like most of the houses, what my husband brings would suffice, but I think adding to the financial element boosts the development of the whole family.
The other one is, like I talked about, being in the women, the growing women, and being the chairperson for the Indian Women's Council. And not only that, I think since the time we set up, we already have seen two other chairpersons, so it is not like dependent on an individual. But I think it's a growing organization doing different things. So that's something I feel really proud of being a part of.
See, right before this venture, I was working as a CEO for a company, okay? Even though that was an IT company, I ended up actually, spending about a year and a half constructing 100,000 square feet office space in an IT park, okay, in Chennai, which has nothing to do with IT, nothing to do with the deliveries or clients or, software or technology. That kind of gave me an opportunity and an awareness to say, hey, if you're a CEO, you should be able to do just about anything.
I'm actually I always say I'm in this no man's land. I'm neither a communications engineer, full-fledged, nor am I a full computing engineer. I'm actually in the marriage between two of them. And today I'm very happy being there. Because there's lots of stuff that I learn in all these areas.
We had to struggle in life coming from small cities. I'm sure the kids we have will have much more facilities and more direction.
I felt I could have been mentored in my growing years. There wasn't many people that I could look forward to and go in this career path. I was always in the dark. I didn't know which path would be correct for me.
Access to information, the relevant information or required information, was not so easy like it is these days. And we had to struggle a lot to, get any information about any technology or software.
In consulting, it ended up to be more of a horizontal growth, and I couldn't grow vertically was what I felt. Maybe after about a year, that thought came, I switched over. So that stretch of time, had I been able to reduce, I feel I could have grown little higher.
Definitely sticking on to the same job would have made me grow faster in that organization, because you don't need to go prove yourself to multiple people and multiple opportunities. So I think that would have tapped or exploited my potential better and grown faster.
One of the things when we talk about the product development or a growing organization is technical leadership. I wish I could have had, if I continued in the technical, I would have, I said, did I miss moving to management? That's one thing I always keep thinking. But the other one is having more technical role models, having more technical people within the organization. I wish I could have done more, or I wish I had more people that I could have grown into those positions who are really role models for people there.
I think I should be more exposed to areas like support, where we exactly see what our customers are doing, how it is being received at the end user, and how the marketing happens, how they deal with our products, what is their view on us. So I think I should be exposed on all different perspectives, so that it will give me a complete wholesome view of the product I'm working on.
All these multiple switching jobs have also not given me a very good domain expertise, if I would call, because I worked in audio applications, I worked in automotive applications, embedded systems and mobile applications in different companies. Though I was with system engineering all through, the applications where these systems went into were different. So I did not get a very domain expertise in a specific field, right? So it's more like my skills that I have developed and not really much on the domain.
The company was ready to hand over a bunch of projects to me, okay? They said, well, why don't you take this, this? And I'm like, oh no, you know, I'm in the last 1 year of 12 months, you know, I have spent 7 months in India, you know, in the US. It kind of completely defeated the purpose of why I wanted to move back to India. So I really don't want to take any more projects. I want to go to India and you know, only do services to companies in Chennai, okay? By far, that is the worst mistake I've done, you know, because, if I had the right vision, you know, if I had the entrepreneurial spirit, I would have jumped at that opportunity immediately. I should have expanded that market and I should have established an office there. Who knows, you know, I would have been another, I don't know, Infosys.
Even today, that hasn't changed that much, that, you know, a middle-aged person comes for a trainee job and there is a lot of hesitation. Even within my company, I should be very honest about it. I don't know whether my HR will take a person like me coming, walking in and then saying that I've done these courses, so I want to become a trainee. You still are being looked upon because people consider only the youngsters to be fit enough to be trainees.
I understood that the way I was teaching was not correct. I should give more problematic approach to my students, because they are not going to be a teacher. They will be working in industry, so I should give more importance to not than teaching the concepts, rather than giving some problems, how to solve them. Those things I understood after coming here.
The way computer science is taught at undergraduate level should be better, especially in countries like India. And I feel that the industry has a lot of work to do here, because just being industry majors, they expect the best of talent, but they need to understand that the best of talent can come when the students in their undergraduate students, especially in the undergraduate level, get the right kind of exposure and as early as possible. So the companies need to be more involved in the entire education system.
And another thing probably I should have focused was my own, personal financial investments. You know, somehow I didn't devote much time.
When it was time for raising kids, I could never sit back and relax and have luxury that I could take a break. and feel confident that, you know, I'll be able to go back to workplace if I took a break.
Being a woman, I have to be at home at a certain time. I mean, it's not as bad as, like, you know, reach home at 7 or something, but then, yeah, a decent timing. So, there were a couple of times when I felt that if I would not have this constraint on me, yes, I would have been able to take up this particular challenge and put my best to it. That would have given me a chance to grow, that would have given my skills to be put to use to the company.
I had to put in a lot of effort to convince my parents and had to compromise on a lot of things again to convince my parents for them to allow me to work from Chennai, which was a quite far away place from my native.
I was always interested in vocal music, but I never really got a chance to devote time. So maybe I should have worked harder and done that.
One thing I have to really give credit is that I had a very, very supportive family, whether it was my in-laws or my family, that is my husband or my children or my parents. Everybody was supportive to whatever I was trying to do.
Primarily my parents, they were very much instrumental in me taking a serious career.
I think my father was more in support. He wanted me to go into, into engineering. One thing he had always insisted was that women had to be educated and they had to be independent.
My parents, first of all, they are very proud of me, and my kids are very proud of me, and, it means a lot to them, like, you know, the way I take calls and the way I work. They see me, work through the day, the night, and they learn hard work from me. They learn balancing work and house from me.
I don't think any of the kids here, the two girls, can think of, being without a job or not having a career or being fully housewife, given that they have seen their mom working all their lives.
My immediate family members and all, my husband is also in the same field, so he understands me very well. I mean, no problems.
So naturally, my family members regard me as a geek because I am almost the first member of my family to come into the computing field. And my junior cousins and friends, they always look forward to me for advice on their career path.
Because my parents are not from the computing age and they did not have the need to be very highly enlightened about technology, so I'm basically the one at home who's advising them and checking out the computing aspects or technical geeky aspects of the devices.
Like, it a lot of respect, and also all the junior and family friends who has their daughters, so they started consulting me, like, how does it feel when you join the IT industry, is it safe or not? So, and when I told them my experience, they were quite surprised and they were quite comfortable. Okay, like, they can let their daughters choose the computer field and they can go ahead and join the IT industry.
They just certainly think that you are very determined, very committed to career, and you have achieved. And of course, they certainly associate financial independence along with it.
I've made my co-sister an entrepreneur. Okay, I mean, it may not be a direct inducement, might be, but the indirect inducement of having seen me coming up and doing things, that has given them that, I should also do.
If their friends say that my dad has a Dell laptop, then my daughter's extremely proud telling that my mom makes them, right? And she comes and tells me that, yeah, mom, I told her that you make those for her dad. So I'm sure all these will be a lot of inspiration and motivation in their life.
For my friend who live in my native till date, I'm an achiever, so they totally admire me.
They told everyone that my one friend is, she is in IIT Bombay CS, So, we felt very good because everyone, their reaction is same, that she is in IIT Bombay CS, she is in IIT Bombay CS, that's that kind of reaction.
So most work was from the US, and most times the entire team had to work late in the nights. Initially my parents didn't understand, they didn't want to understand basically, and it became a huge trouble for me, but I had to explain them a lot to make them understand that my future will not be affected by these working late nights, and I had to assure a lot of things to them. And in fact my manager also called them, and you know, he assured my safety and well-being in the company. So that's how they got convinced, and it was a big struggle that time.
Extended family with my husband, there were challenges initially for them to accept a woman going for work. I'm talking about 22 years back, because they are from a very conservative family and they were very affluent. They felt why there is a need for money.
15-20 years back, they used to be little surprised at my lifestyle, that you know, I'm spending such long hours in office and also having calls after I come home, or anytime you pack up your bags and go for travel. And then there is one implicit assumption that okay, you know, I must be ignoring on the home front.
Initially I had a little bit of with a little bit of problem with my mother-in-law for a while. Not very, very, very nice person. She could never understand why I will not join them on holiday and I would come independently on my holiday and things like that. And after a while, she began to understand that, you know, what we are doing is also a career. I know that once she began to realize that we are, my husband and wife are two independent people by ourselves and have our own agendas in terms of career, and this perfectly fine.
Yeah, definitely, because we could make a great change not only to our life but to the lives of others also.
I think computer science is the best field for girls, because we don't have to do any physical work over here. If you are intelligent enough, if you have the thinking, if you are conceptually and fundamentally strong, so then you can join computer science.
Today you have a lot of choices, right? So that opens a lot of areas for you.
Computing, I would say, is directly mapped to the intellectual of women, right? So anybody that's, everybody will be happy to exploit their intellectual capabilities and feel happy about that, they're able to contribute intellectually to an organization.
I mean, it's really exciting. It's professional, it's what you can say, you can really build up your career successfully in this field. So I definitely encourage everyone to get into it.
Basically, all the companies recruit women and they have a lot of encouragement programs to recruit women in special. And women, they really do a great job at computing. They're really geniuses.
Women are quite logical. I think that really fits in well with the area that with the computing, that you can go and really achieve a lot. And being management, I think that also comes quite naturally to us. So I feel it's exciting being with technology, doing new things, growing people, seeing the difference you can make to an organization.
I think there is no point in discriminating, like ladies can't do something, gents can do something like that. Even ladies can do something in computing, not especially in teaching, they can do better job than gents, because they are type of emotional people, as you say, so they can understand the feelings of students.
I think it is very, very suitable field for a woman to be, because the working environment, I will say, is quite suitable compared to other industry segments. And what happens is that the qualities which using which you can develop or go ahead in the career, I think women have those qualities inherently.
IT industry is very ideal, very well suited for women, because one, it pays equally. There is no discrimination. Number two, you know, it is, you know, it uses your intelligence. You know, it has nothing to do with your physical power. So, you know, and women have certain qualities like attention to detail, multitasking, great communicators. You know, these are all inherent strength of women.
This is a gender agnostic field. It does not differentiate who is doing the work. So, nobody knows the person who is doing. It's how you are time conscious, how you are quality oriented, and how you are taking the initiative to do more than what is being asked of you.
Because the field itself is very challenging, and I feel it will make anybody feel like, you know, confident. It will give them a lot of confidence. But I would also recommend that they find a company that encourages a good work-life balance.
Why should any field be deprived of 50% of the brains in this country or anywhere in the world? And in that sense, I mean, I'm not saying that, you know, women should come into computing because of any no other reason except that. Why are we depriving 50% of the brains from participating in this whatever information revolution that is there?
Challenging.
Exhilarating.
Amazing.
Learning.
I should say quite adventurous.
Successful.
It's been exciting.
Exciting. It's been very exciting.
This is hectic also, but very nice also.
It's a pleasant experience, I could say.
I would say it was a roller coaster ride for me.
The ability to adapt, adjust and be flexible, because this world is changing so rapidly.
This industry has given enough exposures and has made me realize how to appreciate a customer's problem and business.
I would define it more like a team sport. That's how I feel being, because you cannot win if your team is not supporting you and the team is also not winning. At the same time, you have to always be learning, improve upon what you have learned, because sometimes you compete among yourselves and you compete with other people.
The joy of, you know, getting into a good business relationship where you see that the products that you are working for your clients are becoming an IT enabler for some other company, and that is bringing in an operation efficiency and things like that. That is done by somebody here. That itself, you know, it's a, like, an amazement for me.
Any questions, comments? As long as you all didn't fall asleep, it's okay.
A fascinating film, actually. So I really enjoyed watching it.
Thank you.
How did you pick the folks who you interviewed? Did you have any? Did you just randomly go and choose a few people?
It was just destiny. Okay. So we just sent out, you know, whatever mails we could through contacts, through Facebook, and it was the contacts that sort of came to fruition within the time frame. So it really was just a matter of chance that we got. We wrote to many other people, but some of them were traveling. Some it just didn't happen. So
cool. Yeah, but I especially like the mix of the housewife all the way from the students. So I was wondering how you picked that.
That we had the profiles, and then we wrote to people who matched those profiles. But we wrote to many people who matched a profile, but then, you know, whatever was practically possible, we went to finally a few people who matched the profile. But we were very clear what profiles we wanted.
Thank you.
It was good to see, you know, a cross-section of folks. It was not the usual suspects of the CEO or the top, you know, the people in the higher management. how much did you enjoy making it? Did you learn anything new? Because you said you're not from the computing industry, right? How much did you enjoy it? That's my first question. And the second feedback I had was that it was a great video. It would help if you actually had a more of a profile of this person, especially some of those entrepreneurs, right? Like the person who started when she was middle-aged, you know, if you could just get a bio or something running on the side, it'll be more informative because we can take it back and think over it.
Okay, that's very useful. Thank you for that feedback. We can definitely add that.
Yeah. And the first question, that's for the person who filmed the...
So, Ananya, since you did the shooting and experienced that, why don't you speak about what you learned?
Okay, so I had lots of fun. Firstly, because, okay, so I'll tell you why I'm in user research in the first place is because I like listening to people's stories and I like the voyeuristic part of it being allowed into their lives to whatever extent. And so the same thing was happening here. So I would go to people's homes, offices, and then they would start, you know, telling all these fascinating things would come out, stories, different experiences. Some of those would, you know, I could relate to because I would have had similar experiences. Some of the things would be new. So, and also because I am somewhat of an outsider to the field of computing. So a lot of the things that people mentioned, like technical achievements, things like that, were extremely new to me. And so... basically, all these different 15 different worlds opening up, that was the fun part for me.
Basically. Hi. Hi, here.
Okay.
Hey. So, I really enjoyed your video and seeing women, you know, of different age groups. Speaking at the same, in the same, you know, frame and almost talking the same language is really surprising and makes me feel very normal when I hear women say what they regret doing or not doing in their life, making the wrong choices at times and not taking up the challenges. And I really like the last part where the question was, would you recommend other women to join the computing world? And the last response was, why should we deprive 50% of the population, you know, 50% brain from getting into this industry? That was a very nice response and very nice set of questions. So, well, good job, and thank you for sharing that.
Thank you.
Hi.
Hello.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. You know that as soon as I watched the first 5 minutes of your movie, I just came running down to tell you guys that it's awesome. It's very beautiful to see and, you know, get inspired from normal people in normal lives. Like somebody else was mentioning, this is not from, you know, the CEOs of the computing world. This is from... you know, women in daily lives who were talking about their experiences. And it actually touches, you know, our lives in a better way when we actually see people like us on the screen sharing their experiences. It was really beautiful. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
I have a question. First of all, I think that was a wonderful way to depict those three generations. I'm here.
Can't hear you very clearly.
Okay. So I think that was a wonderful way to depict the three generations of... computing engineers. My question is, 15, 20 years ago, when ladies or women started to get into engineering, it was not a matter of choice. They were the only career options available. So normally it was either engineering or medicine as far as Indian academics go. Every other field didn't get that much attention. And of course, India produces one of the largest producing engineers in the world. Is it still passion that drives women into the engineering field today? Or is it still the misnomer that there is no other field left for us? In these discussions, did you come across any of that?
I think, and I'll let Ananya also speak to that, I think what we got was... now, today, it's not anymore that it's, you know, there's no choice. But those who are in the field or getting into the field are driven by a passion, an enthusiasm, a desire to achieve at a level that changes the whole world, which is what drives them. But there are several other options today that they all talk about, but they didn't take them because they didn't interest them that much.
Yeah, so of these 15 women who we interviewed, actually most of them, they did choose to be in this field. A few of them, I think a couple of them mentioned that it was because there weren't enough options. So it was, like you mentioned, either medicine or engineering, and that's what their parents expected. But for most of them, it was it was a decision that they took and that they were encouraged to then finally achieve.
Firstly, Apala, thank you very much, because I remember when we were first talking, I asked you, why do you want to do this video, and that too for free? Sorry, that's just the nasty bit in me, but I really was wondering why you wanted to do it for free, but it was very, very nice. I just want to add a comment here, because someone just said these are regular, normal women like us. If you notice, there was a lady called Hema, white-haired lady with a thin plait, professor of mathematics in IIT Chennai. She was just shown in the video. She was a panelist last year when we had it at the Taj on MG Road. And at the end of the day, so first when I saw her, she was this lady in a white starch sari, white hair, big bun out here. And she spoke very well, but we thought she seemed a bit out of place. But over tea and coffee and lunch, when she started interacting with us, we were very surprised with her sense of humor, her wit, and the fact that she talked our language. She perfectly synced with all the younger crowd out there. Towards the evening, when we were all waiting for a car to come up the ramp so we can drive back home, I saw this lady walking with her bags out of the gates of Taj. I remember going up to her and asking her if I can book her a cab, and she said IIT Chennai doesn't pay for cabs. I offered to drop her to the railway station because she had a rail ticket back to Chennai, and she refused it. With two bags, practically leaning on either side, she got into an auto and she drove off. That day, I was so embarrassed because I just met someone who was exceptional, who knew so much more because I seemed dumb in front of her. And at the same time, she was so down to earth. So they are not people like us. I think for some of them, they are much, much better than what I am. So just want to mention that about Hema, and I'm glad that you covered her in the video. So thank you.
Okay, thank you so much. And Urbi, we wanted also to know, is there a way we can share this? A lot of the people we interviewed asked us if we can share it with them. So I don't know, do you want us to just share? Do you want the...
Usually the Grace Hopper convention, the core committee rather, Deanna.
Okay.
She generally goes ahead and collates all the videos and the photographs and they upload it on the site.
Okay.
So when that's done, I will let you know and you can share it around.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.